Representative Dakota.
Mr. President, I'd like to speak to a couple of amendments that I have filed to the bill that's under consideration by the Senate today. And I want to talk about Amendment number 1876. And just to kind of give you the background, the context on this, most of us know that when we were debating the health care bill a few years ago, the labor unions were enthusiastic supporters of Obamacare. And it perhaps should come as no surprise that they're having some buyer's remorse. I think they're realizing they were sold a bill of goods. And like a lot of people around this country that I talk to, they would like to have a do-over. In fact, if you look at what's happened since the legislation has become law and what's happened to premiums, they continue going up. In fact, there was a Kaiser study just this last month that had premiums, family premiums, going up $3,000 on average since President Obama took office. And of course, that was after the promise that health care premiums were going to go down by $2,500. You've seen employers either cut jobs or slash hours. In fact, 250 employers have cut jobs, and there's hardly a day that goes by where there isn't a headline in a major newspaper about some employer that is having to reduce their workforce or not hiring people they otherwise would hire simply because of the additional costs, the requirements, the mandates, all the uncertainty created by Obamacare. And of course, what that means is the people who are getting hired for part-time jobs. If you look at the number of jobs that's been created this year, about 77% of those are part-time jobs. What's happening? Well, a lot of employers, those who are under 50 employees, if they go over 50, obviously they're covered by the mandate that says that they have to provide government-approved health care, so they're keeping the number under 50 employees. And then the other requirement is that to qualify as a full-time employee, you have to work 30 hours a week. So employers are also reducing the hours of their employees. So we've got more now 29-hour-a-week jobs in this country, I think, than we've ever had before. And the numbers since the beginning of the year with regard to jobs created, part-time jobs, really do bear that out. More and more employers are finding their way to reduce hours of employees and hire people for jobs that are part-time jobs as opposed to full-time jobs. What does that mean? Well, that means that the take-home pay of middle-class Americans is going down. And in order to make ends meet, they're now having to get that second job. And so it's creating all kinds of the distortions in the labor force. And so it's no surprise, I would think, that the labor unions would like to have this issue revisited. And I want to share with you something that a couple of statements that have been made. The International Brotherhood of Teamsters, UFCW, and Unite Here. This was a letter to House Minority Leader Nancy Pelosi and Senate Majority Leader Harry Reid sent in July. On behalf of the millions of working men and women we represent and the families they support, we can no longer stand silent in the face of elements of the health care law that will destroy the very health and well-being of our members, along with millions of other hardworking Americans. The United Union of Roofers, Waterproofers, and Allied Workers is, and this was from a letter several months ago in April, I am therefore calling for repeal or complete reform of the Affordable Care Act to protect our employers, our industry, and our most important asset, our members and their families. And if you look at the letter that was sent July 11th by the three unions I mentioned earlier, it goes on to say that it will create nightmare scenarios, it will shatter benefits, and actually that it will destroy the backbone of the middle class, which is the 40-hour work week. And so very strong language by some of those who are the most enthusiastic and strongest advocates and supporters of Obamacare when it was being discussed and debated here in the Senate. And last night at their annual convention, the AFL-CIO passed a resolution calling for major changes to Obamacare. Mr. President, the unions are trying to get a special deal. And they want to work with the administration in a way that completely ignores the text of Obamacare. The law says that anyone that has an offer from their employer of a government-approved health care coverage is not eligible to go into the exchanges and receive refundable health care premium tax credits. The law also states that union-provided insurance, known as Taft-Hartley multi-employer health plans, is government-approved health care coverage. Consequently, union employees enrolled in these Taft-Hartley plans are not eligible for the exchanges and the refundable premium tax credits that are available in the exchange. Well, obviously, the unions are not happy about that. In fact, on August 27th in 2013, the trade publication Inside Health Policy reported, and I quote, "The Office of Management and Budget previously showed on its regulatory review website that on August 24th, it received a Department of Labor proposed rule on health insurance premium assistance trusts supporting the purchase of certain individual health insurance policies. The rule, which OMB said is Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act related, also appears to deal with the exclusion from a definition of an employee welfare benefit plan, but this week the description disappeared," end quote. The unions are clearly seeking a way around the law and want a special fix that would apply to them and to them only. If they have their way, Mr. President, what essentially happens is that union members will receive government subsidies for their insurance plans from three different sources and three different ways, a benefit position that no other organization or individual is in. First, they get the tax deduction that an employer receives for contributing to a union health plan. Second, they will get the non-taxable income that the employee receives when his or her employer purchases a union health plan. And three, and finally, a new premium assistance tax credit for union members who purchase a union health plan. Now, recent analysis from the American Action Forum shows that if the administration gives labor unions what they want, it would cost taxpayers $187 billion over the next 10 years. The new health care law, Mr. President, is clear that taxpayer-funded premium assistance credits are intended for low- to middle-income Americans without access to affordable insurance through an employer or who purchase health insurance on the exchanges. The fact is that Taft-Hartley union health plans are not exchange-based plans. They are employer-sponsored health plans. Providing union members with a premium assistance tax credit on top of the favorable tax treatment already afforded to them for their employer-sponsored coverage amounts to double-dipping for union workers and is grossly unfair to every non-union worker in America who would receive no such special benefit.
Be in order. Please proceed.
Mr. President, the law states that union employees should not receive both Taft-Hartley coverage and premium tax credits, but the administration's made it abundantly clear that they're willing to ignore this law in other areas. And that's why I've introduced as a bill and as an amendment to the pending legislation, the Union Bailout Prevention Act that would seek to close off any possible loophole that the administration might create or could use to give unions a special fix. Mr. President, I don't blame at all the unions or other Americans around this country for not liking what they got. I think a lot of people had higher hopes, and those obviously who supported this and enthusiastically supported the health care law are now realizing that this isn't what they were promised. And as a consequence of that, a lot of them would like to see a do-over. They want to see changes. They want to see reforms. Some want to see a repeal. That obviously would be my preference in all this. But it is not fair to carve out groups of people at the exclusion or detriment of other Americans who would be unfairly impacted by that carve-out. And that is essentially what they're requesting here. They're trying to get special treatment that would allow them not to claim one, not two, but three special tax provisions or tax treatment as a result of the new Affordable Care Act, when in fact, under Taft-Hartley plans, they already receive favorable tax treatment, and they are in government-approved plans. That is a government-approved plan, therefore not eligible for the exchanges, as are many other Americans who don't have access to some sort of employer-provided health care plan. And so if this carve-out were something that the administration were to approve, it would create a special treatment, a special provision that would cost taxpayers billions and billions of dollars and be completely unfair to countless Americans who would love to see the provisions of this law either repealed or delayed for them as well. Now, the better solution, I would argue, is let's delay this for everybody. I'd like to see it repealed. I think we could have done a much better job. We didn't need a 2,700-page bill and 20,000 pages of regulations to deal with some of the challenges and problems that we have in our healthcare system today. But that's what we have. We have a government takeover of our healthcare system. We have 20,000 pages of regulations, which, by the way, is significantly taller than I am. It's about 7 feet tall when you stack those regulations. Somebody has to interpret all that. Somebody has to make sense out of it. And obviously, as people start to interpret and make sense out of it, they're not liking what they're finding. And that shouldn't come as any surprise, because when you get a massive expansion of the government, which is essentially what this was, a takeover of literally one-sixth of the American economy, you're going to have a lot of associated unintended consequences. And I think it would make a lot of sense. And there's so many better ways of going about this if we were to repeal this and start over. But at a minimum, if one group is going to get special treatment, then all Americans ought to get that same treatment. And the best way to do that, I would argue, Mr. President, is to delay this for everybody across this country, not to create special carve-outs, special treatment that would apply to just a small number of Americans when there are literally millions of Americans who are impacted by this new law. Mr. President, I would also like to address briefly, if I might, and this is another amendment that I filed to this bill, and it has to do, it's amendment number 1887, and it has to do with the Department of Energy loan program that has already cost taxpayers millions in bad investments. It is the Advanced Technology Vehicle Manufacturing Program. It was intended to provide loans for manufacturing facilities that produce fuel-efficient vehicles. However, after making only 5 loans over the past several years, this program was mothballed in 2011. Remarkably, Secretary Moniz is considering reviving this program and is reportedly seeking new applications for the ATVM program. Now, Mr. President, I've introduced this amendment because the Obama administration has not proven itself to be a very good venture capitalist. If you look at the record of the 5 recipients of ATVM loans, one is bankrupt, another has suspended their payments on a $192 million loan. The Government Accountability Office has also questioned whether the Department of Energy has the expertise to properly assess loan applications. The GAO has also concluded that the Department of Energy lacks the engineering expertise needed for effective technical oversight. Mr. President, not only is this program poorly managed, it's no longer needed. Credit markets and the auto industry have largely recovered from the recession, and industry participants have shown little interest in the ATVM program in recent years. Additionally, stricter fuel economy standards, which automakers supported, promote vehicle technologies that are subsidized by the loan program. The ATVM program has $16.6 billion in outstanding lending authority, and according to GAO, that is a credit subsidy risk of over $4 billion. Now, I have offered this amendment to prohibit any new loans from being made under the ATVM program and to protect taxpayers from this outstanding exposure. Given the Energy Department's poor track record and the fact that these subsidies are no longer necessary, I would urge my colleague to support my amendment to stop the administration from making additional risky loans and losing even more taxpayer dollars. So, Mr. President, I hope that we will get a chance to vote on these amendments. I know that the manager of the bill, the Senator from Oregon, is working with others to try and come up with a path forward in terms of processing amendments. But this is certainly one that, in my view, would save the government, the taxpayers, some money. And if you look at the record, I think that most Americans would agree this is not the way they want to see their money used. Mr. President, I yield the floor.